bah, tour à tour. Finish off now the geometric discussion of the first and second variation of area. So, so this is our game. We're going to do, I guess there's hardly going to be any recap. The recap is going to be woven in. So we want to discuss first and second, so it's been on the menu in a few lectures now, and today will be the final discussion. I'm going to take that back. First and second. So this is the variation. Area, and we're going to discuss it now not for one simple immersion, so with domain and open subset. Of Euclidean space, but really first and second variation when you have of area and long families of embedded surfaces and your hypersurfaces of Euclidean space. So this is four families of embedded. So the second that we're going to do to next is to also resume a discussion that we've somehow half finished. This is the proof of Bernstein's theorem. So mind you, it's actually Sergei Bernstein, and he was born in Odessa. So and was born in 1882. So I looked this up, but it's really interesting. So when you look him up on Wikipedia, not that it is, that's the base of references, but to get an idea. So Edwin Gedi, I'm sorry, he died in 1968. So he was one of the very prominent mathematicians of his time. Advisor Hilbert and Picard got his PhD at Sorbonne, was born in Odessa, which was then was Russian at the time. So this, unlike at the time when you have Galicia, for example, then Alt-Österreich around 1918, Odessa was Russian at the time, and this way was this, Kherson, this is Ukraine, and then Hessen for a long time. So Sergei Bernstein, but Sergei Bernstein's theorem, so this is the fact that when you have a smooth function in R2, so smooth, let's just say a smooth function, so a smooth function in R, on R2, such that the minimal surface equation is satisfied. So that's the, if you want, geometric Laplace equation, so it's the equation that are divergence. So I guess I've made a final judgment call that I am going to follow my gut and call this Euclidean, denote this Euclidean gradient just by partial in the norm plus the length of this Euclidean gradient squared is equal to zero. So if this equation is satisfied by entirely by a function that is defined on all of R2, then U is linear. So this is Bernstein's theorem, and we'll prove Bernstein's theorem, but we're not going to follow this original proof, which, as far as I could tell from browsing this paper for 2 minutes, is beautiful. So You know, if you want to understand how mathematics actually evolved, you know, this proof is an old-fashioned proof. But, you know, it somehow it was known to continue the minimal surface theory because it didn't extend to higher dimensions. But when you look at, you know, pseudo-holomorphic curves, for example, you know, these techniques are, you know, this is where you should start reading. Also, if you want to practice your French or learn French, when I was still, well, okay, so in the United States, when you get a PhD in mathematics, you also have to take language exams. Have to. So this has been, you know, the bar has been lowered. Would you agree?
I don't know. I mean, I can't. So we had to prove ability to translate. That was.
Exactly. And classical texts were used for this.
Yes.
So you got, you know. So this is how graduate students in the United States. I think this is really phased out of. Has been phasing out. People are phasing this out of graduate education in the United States.
Yep.
But. You know, these papers are so clearly written, and you can connect, right, between the mathematical symbols with a basic mathematical vocabulary. And it's such a beautiful way of learning with languages, and this is also how mathematicians used to learn languages, is by studying papers, I claim. But, you know, the French is so clear. It's, you know, there's no... Also, there's a famous collection of essays by Bernhard Riemann. No, it's a collection of essays, including one by Bernhard Riemann from his habilitation talk. I think it's published as a collection by the AMS. There's also an article by Cantor, you know, famously, clearly written, brilliant papers. So if you, you know, these are in German, so I remember that was a recommendation for those who wanted to take the language in German to read these essays. So we're not going to...
So did you do German?
I think I had one conversation.
Yeah, I know, but it's kind of teaching. It's kind of cheating. Yeah, you could have taken French or Russian, just so you don't take advantage of the fact that.
No, we had to take two. I mean, that was the formal requirement, and French and German are. At that time, I spoke French.
Oh, you had to take two languages. Oh, okay. We had to choose one: Russian, French, or German. Yeah. Okay.
No, I did. But I already spoke French.
Yeah.
So.
Which one did you say? Sorry.
Russian.
Oh.
Yeah, of course.
Now we back to. Sorry. So this is basic theory, and we're going to give a relatively modern proof of this, which, as far as I can tell, dates back to a paper of Algren's from so now I have to cheat again, because I somehow, when I look, you know, I've checked several papers for historical references on this, but I actually couldn't find. I'm pretty sure it's a 1962 paper by Algren, where he proves essentially in the way 1966 paper by Algren. The result in the way, the proof of basic theory that I'm going to present with you, I believe, is really. From this paper of Algren's. So it's not the original proof, it's a modern proof, and that proof is, this is the proof that has been, you know, eventually been extended to higher dimensions. Most notably by the work of James Simons in a series of three papers. 1967, 68. So, it's...
do you
want
to link them on to those papers?
Sure.
I've
started to
link
papers on.
Ah, okay. Didn't
have
a look, by the way.
Did you know? And then I would like to, you know, with the time that remains, I hope you will get this up. Oh, by the way, can you please watch my hourglass? You know, I don't actually know how much time it measures. Would you please observe this? But you know, these hourglasses, they really give me a lot of calm. So when I have my hourglass, my teddy, and You with me? So again, I would like to, you know, I will again. I'm sorry. This is somehow historical. So I'm trying to, you know, also share with you my impression of how this area of mathematics happened historically. Even though I'm not an expert on this, but I'm really eager to learn this. I think it's important for several reasons. Also purely mathematically, you know, some of the where do the ideas that really propelled 20th century mathematics at all, where did they originate? What's their story? What were people thinking when they did this? So, and then I would like to talk a little bit. So, finally, I mean, we wanted to prove the Douglas-Adler theorem, so the fact that minimal soap films exist. You know, from our point of view today, I guess that's a PDE result. The proof that we are going to give is much less geometric than the rest of the course. But I need to finish it because that's, you know, in the course syllabus. And there is some background on first and second variation of area. So I prepared notes very carefully. First and second variation. Area. I'm going to assume that return to my notes, so I'm not screwing up the language in which I'm going to present this. So these are notes that I prepared last week, so I can do better now. It's Bernstein. Okay, looks like a little more freelance. suppose that sigma node in R and P form is an orient hyper surface, an oriented hyper surface. So oriented is equivalent to being two-sided. Oriented in an oriented or manifold is the equivalent of being two-sided, so there is a unit normal field, oriented hypersurface, in Rn plus 1. And I would like to, so hypersurface always means embedded, right? If you think about it, this discussion also makes sense for immersed hypersurfaces, but I want to draw the line somewhere. So let's stick with I would like to look at a geometric variation of such a surface. So what is this? So you need a family. So you know, an oriented hypersurface, if you have a notion of F-strict manifolds, is an embedding of the F-strict manifold sigma naught with its induced smooth structure into Rn plus 1 by the inclusion method, the embedding method, right? And a family of smoothly from the interval I across one particular hypersurface into I zone. So smooth such that there are interval, so zero is in I smooth. And such that when I look at the sections, so when I hit one T fix, so that is then a map from sigma naught to R n plus 1 is an embedding for R. Family of embeddings,
mm-hmm.
and we think of it as a variation of the original surface. Embedding such that phi. Zero is the inclusion, just the inclusion. Sigma naught including R inference. So such a configuration we are going to. Going to call sigma t, so denote by so the image of this immersion. This is a hypersurface by definition, and if you think about it, it must also be oriented and thus have a unit normal field. This is something that you cannot use alone. Can this be seen?
Mm.
Both sides?
Yes. Not that one.
Huh.
But I can move it maybe. Should
no.
I try?
No.
The
so
third
this
one
is going
no, no.
to be my secret hole.
Okay, yep.
So if I okay. So this is where I go when I don't want things to be there. Can you still see it?
No, this is okay. Except it.
I'm also going to denote the geometric quantities that we can associate to sigma t, right? And when we think of them, you know, I guess by Poulbeck, as geometric quantities on sigma naught,